blood vessels of the upper limb, lower limb, as well as the heart. All three together. So the morning lecture we learned about the blood vessels of the heart, right?
Yes.
The coronary circulation, the coronary vessels. So after that, coronary vessels will take at the end of this lab, okay? But begin with the vessels of the upper and lower limb. So you already know the subclavian artery.
Yes.
Explained it in the last class, so the blood vessels of the head, neck and thorax. So subclavian artery continues as
axillary
artery from the outer border of the first rib.
Yes.
It continues as the axillary artery till the lower border of the teres major muscle. From the teres major muscle, it continues in the arm as the brachial artery. You know that. So it is the same single artery which is given different name in different regions. In the neck, root of the neck region, it is called as subclavian. When it comes to the axilla, it is called as axillary. When it comes to the arm, it is called as brachial artery. It is the same one artery which is given different name. So you already know the different branches of the subclavian. So subclavian was divided by which muscle? Scalenius anterior muscle into three parts. Similarly, so from the outer border of the first rib, the axillary artery begins.
Yes.
So axillary artery is from outer border of the first rib till to the lower border of the teres major muscle. Okay, till that part we call it as axillary artery, which is present in the axilla, covered by axillary sheath. Similar to your carotid artery in the carotid sheath, axillary artery along with the axillary vein, it is there in the sheath, what we call it as axillary sheath. Okay, so this axillary artery is divided into three parts. Okay, so where it is there, axillary artery, it is begins from the outer part of the first rib from subclavian artery till the lower part of the teres major muscle. Okay, so this is present in the axilla covered by axillary sheath. So this axillary artery, mainly the second part of the axillary artery, is closely related to the brachial plexus. What? The brachial plexus. So that's why we have the lateral cord, medial cord, posterior cord, you know, the brachial plexus.
Yes.
Three cords. Medial, lateral and posterior cords. Why they are named as lateral, medial and posterior cords? They are named as lateral, medial and posterior cords according to the relation of these cords with the brachial, with the second part of the axillary artery. The cord which is medial to the second part of the axillary artery is called as medial cord. The cord which is lateral to that artery is called as lateral cord, and posterior to the artery is called as posterior cord. So the cords of the brachial plexus are named as medial, lateral and posterior in relation to
second part
of the axillary artery. So that's how they are related to the second part of the axillary artery. Okay, and then this axillary artery, as I already know it, is divided by the pectoralis minor muscle, similar to scalenus anterior for the subclavian. So this axillary artery divided into three parts by the pectoralis minor muscle. From the outer border of the first rib till to the lateral border of the muscle is the first part. You can make out in this picture. This is the axillary artery. Okay, this is the first rib. Are you following?
Yes, sir, yes.
So up to here it is the subclavian.
Yes, subclavian.
So from the outer border of the first rib, this is the pectoralis minor muscle.
Yes.
Okay, till this part, medial border, it is the first part of the artery. Behind the muscle is the second part of the artery. And from here, the lateral border of the muscle till to the lower border of the teres major muscle. This is the teres major muscle. This part up to here, this is the third part. The third part, second part, first part of the axillary artery in the axilla.
What's the name of the muscle?
This one?
Yes.
The pectoralis minor muscle. Pectoralis minor muscle divides the axillary artery into three parts. From its origin, that is outer part of the first rib till to the outer part of the muscle, is the first part, second part behind the muscle, third part afterwards, till the lower part of the teres major muscle. Teres major muscle. From here down, it is called as
brachial
artery, which is there in the arm.
Yes.
Am I clear?
Yes.
So these three parts of the axillary artery give different branches. The first part, it gives an artery called as highest thoracic artery.
Okay,
second part, two branch. First part, one branch. Second part, two branch. Third part, three branch. Okay, second part, two branches. They are thoracoacromial artery and then lateral thoracic artery. Am I clear? Second part, two branches, thoracoacromial and
lateral
thoracic. Okay. So I have, as the name only indicates, they are limited to the thorax. Whereas the thoracoacromial artery is supplying both the acromial area as well as the thoracic area. Okay. And even you have, and even the deltoid muscle also it supplies. And then you have third part, three branches. Okay. Two are circumflex humeral, one anterior and one posterior, which circumflex the neck of the humerus.
Yes, sir.
One anterior and one posterior. They are anterior and posterior circumflex humeral artery, and one more branch is subscapular artery, which supplies the anterior scapular muscles, okay, like subscapularis muscle. Okay, am I clear?
Yes.
So these are the three parts of the axillary artery by pectoralis minor muscle. And each part branches. Remember like this. First part, one branch. Second part, two branch. Third part, three branch. First part, highest thoracic. Second part, thoracoacromial lines of lateral thoracic. Third part, two circumflex. Anterior and posterior and one subscapular. Clear? So from the lateral lower part of the stereus major muscle, it continues in the arm as brachial artery. So next come to the brachial artery. So very important here clinically, brachial artery. So most of the course of the brachial artery is superficial. That means below the skin.
Yes.
Below the skin. First it runs on the medial side, the medial side of the arm, and then comes on the anterior side and goes in front of the elbow or cuboidal fossa, where it becomes deep.
Yes.
Where it becomes deep at the level of the neck of the radius, then it divides into two branches.
Yes.
Two terminal branches. They are radial and ulnar arteries. Okay. So as I said, first it is there in the medial side of the arm.
Superficial.
Okay. It is superficial. When it comes anterior to the elbow, it becomes deep.
Yes.
Okay. So here it is superficial. So that's why this becomes very important clinically. As it is superficial, it can be compressed. It can be compressed and used to measure the blood pressure.
Yes.
Am I clear? So that's why the brachial artery is chosen to measure the blood pressure. Why it is chosen?
Superficial.
Because it is superficial and it can be easily compressed. Okay. So that is the brachial artery course. So this is the main artery, brachial artery branch. So one big branch it gives. Okay. So this is the profunda brachii artery. In the arm it gives one big branch. What is called as profunda brachii artery, which runs along with the radial nerve with the posterior compartment of this. You know that arm is divided into anterior and posterior compartments,
yes,
right?
Yes.
So anterior, the muscles, they are direct branches from brachial artery. They are called as muscular branches.
Yes, yes.
Okay? Whereas posterior compartment of the arm is supplied by one big branch that is called as profunda brachii artery. What branch?
Profunda
brachii artery. Is it mentioned? Okay, you can remember. Profunda brachii artery. You can see here, brachial, only the artery is shown here. Okay? This is the brachial artery. So one big branch. So this is the profunda brachii artery, which runs along with the radial nerve in the spiral groove. Okay? Supplying the posterior compartment muscles. Other than that, anterior compartment muscles, they are direct muscular branches. They are direct muscular branches. And even it gives one nutrient artery to the bone. To the bone humerus, okay, and then you have the other vessels which run down towards the elbow. They are called as collateral branches. What they are called as? Collateral branches. One superior and one inferior. Superior and inferior ulnar collateral. Okay, you know that all around the joints, everywhere in the joint, there is anastomosis. Okay, to have the distal limb with the blood flow whenever there is movement of the joint.
Yes.
Okay. So to, for that reason there is anastomosis around the joint. Yes.
So this was before reaching to the end of the.
Yeah, yeah. So I'm talking about the branches of the brachial.
So this is more superficial.
Yeah.
Superficial, this branches, because the brachial here it is superficial. And
the branches they go deep. As I said, the profunda brachii artery is a branch which goes deep to these muscles along with the radial nerve. Brachial artery is superficial. Okay. So you have two collateral branches, one superior ulnar collateral and one inferior ulnar collateral, which run towards the elbow, taking part in the anastomosis around the elbow joint. Similarly, the profunda brachii artery also gives collateral branches. They are called as radial collateral branches. Are you following?
Yes.
So radial collateral branches are from profunda brachii artery. Ulnar collateral are branches from direct from brachii. So collaterals, both ulnar collaterals and then radial collaterals. Okay. Both on the medial side as well as lateral side. Lateral side, radial collateral are from profunda brachii. Whereas medial side, ulnar collateral are from brachial artery. Other than those, what do you have? You have muscular branches and nutrient branches to the bone itself. That is humerus. Am I clear about the brachial artery?
Yes.
So terminal branches are radial and ulnar. Where? Yes. The neck of the radius. Neck of the radius. Okay. So this is anastomosis around the elbow joint. So I explained collateral branches. On the medial side, ulnar collateral branches. On the lateral side, radial collateral branches. So collateral branches, they run down. Then you have recurrent branches.
Yes.
On the radial side, radiant recurrent arteries.
Yes.
And from the ulnar artery, ulnar recurrent arteries.
Yes.
So collaterals, recurrent, they make anastomosis. Am I clear?
Yes.
Recurrent because they run upwards. From the radial artery, radial recurrent arteries, and from the ulnar, yes. So no problem. Yeah, okay. Radial collateral branches anastomose with radial recurrent branches. Ulnar collateral branches anastomose with ulnar recurrent branches. So that is the anastomosis around the elbow joint. Okay. So now come to the radial and ulnar arteries. So the ulnar artery, it's a bigger branch compared to the radial. So after, soon after its origin, it runs along the medial side of the forearm along with the ulnar nerve. Okay. So that radial artery also runs along the thumb side, the lateral side of the forearm. So one important branch from the ulnar artery soon after its origin is common intraosseous artery. What is that? Common intraosseous artery. Soon after its origin, this intraosseous artery divides into two branches.
Yes.
One is anterior intraosseous artery and one is posterior intraosseous artery. Anterior intraosseous artery supplies the deeper muscles of the anterior compartment.
In the forearm.
In the forearm. Okay. Whereas posterior intraosseous artery supplies the posterior compartment muscles in the forearm. Am I clear?
Yes.
Okay. Whereas all the other superficial muscles, they are supplied by this ulnar artery, direct branches, direct muscular one. So what is the big branch from ulnar artery in the forearm?
Common
intraosseous artery, which in turn divides into anterior and posterior intraosseous artery, which run, as the name indicates, anterior intraosseous artery, anterior to the intraosseous membrane, posterior intraosseous artery, posterior intraosseous membrane. Clear? So, after reaching the wrist, the ulnar artery enters the hand, superficial to the retinaculum. Very important. How it enters the forearm?
Superficial
to the flexor retinaculum. Flexor retinaculum. So there, much of this artery continues as superficial palmar arch. Or you can say it gives a branch called a superficial palmar branch, which makes superficial palmar arch. And it gives one more branch, the deep palmar branch, which completes the deep palmar arch. Am I clear? So this is the story about, and even it gives some of the branches which takes part around the anastomosis around the wrist joint. Anastomosis around the wrist joint. Now come to the radial artery. It also runs down. It also runs down at the wrist. At the wrist, it is directly lying on the bone. At the wrist, it is directly lying on the bone where you feel the pulsation, radial pulse. The radial artery is the one which you choose to measure the pulse rate, okay, because it lies directly on the bone, on the anterior surface of the lower end of the radius. And after that, the artery crosses to the dorsal side. Are you following?
Yes.
Goes to the dorsal side by passing through the snuff box. This is the snuff box.
Yes.
Okay. And then it pierces the first dorsal intermetacarpal space here between this and this. It pierces and then goes deep in the palm. Deep in the palm. So there it gives three branches. The termination of the radial artery is by three. One to the thumb, that is called as arteria princeps pollicis. Okay. And one to the radialis indicis, to the index finger. And the other forms the deep palmar arch. Completed by deep branch of ulnar. Am I clear?
Yes.
So before winding round to the dorsal surface, This radial artery gives one superficial branch which crosses the flexor retinaculum anteriorly and completes the superficial palmar. I hope you followed.
Is it written here, doctor? Is it written?
So this is lab. I didn't bring the text. So you will be learning it in again in the lecture which you are having on Thursday. Okay? So I repeat again. So I'm talking about the palmar arches. Okay? Or termination of the radial and ulnar arteries at the hand. So first let's begin with the ulnar artery. As I said, it runs along the medial side of the forearm along with the ulnar nerve, then enters the hand.
Yes.
This is palmar side, this is dorsal side.
Yes.
Enters the hand superficial to retinaculum. Okay? So there much of the artery continues as superficial palmar arch. Okay? Then this palmar arch is completed by a palmar branch from radial.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, see here. This is the ulnar artery. This is retinaculum. Okay? So now this ulnar artery enters the hand by passing superficial to the arch. There it continues as arch like this.
Okay.
Are you following?
Yes.
This is superficial palmar arch.
Yes.
And one more branch is there. This is deep branch which goes deep.
Yes.
Okay? Just remember up to this point here. Okay? So now come to radial artery. Radial artery here. So radial artery
deep.
At the wrist, it goes on the dorsal side. It goes dorsal side. Okay? Before going dorsal side, it gives one branch that is called as superficial branch, which goes and completes this arch.
Yes.
Am I clear?
Yes.
So that's how the superficial palmar arch is completed.
By the radial and ulnar.
Main artery which forms the superficial is ulnar. It is completed by a branch from radial. Am I clear?
Yes.
Okay. So now this on the dorsal side, dotted line.
Go to the thumb.
Dorsal side pierces here between the first dorsal metacortical space, between thumb and index. Here it pierces.
Yes.
Exactly this point.
Okay.
It goes deep. It goes
deep.
And then after going deep,
it gives a branch.
Okay, it gives one branch to the thumb. Arteria princeps pollicis. And one branch to the index finger. Arteria radialis indicis. And one big branch which completes this arch. Anastomosis with deep branch from ulnar. Am I clear?
The dorsal side.
Yeah, and the deeper part of palmar.
Okay.
Deep. Superficial, just after reflecting the skin, you find superficial palmar arch.
Okay.
Deep to the muscles.
Mm.
So that's why the name superficial palmar arch and deep palmar arch. Am I clear?
Yes.
The superficial palmar arch is formed by ulnar, completed by a branch from radial. Deep palmar arch is formed by
radial,
completed by ulna.
Okay.
So deep palmar arch mainly by radial, superficial palmar arch mainly by ulna. What are the branches from radial? Deep, arteria princeps pollicis to the thumb, arteria radialis indicis. Am I clear?
Yes.
So that's how the two arches are formed, superficial palmar arch and then deep palmar arches. From these arches, there are branches which are called as metacarpal arteries, which divide into distal branches. Clear? You will learn them again in the lecture. Don't you? I can show you the picture so you will understand. So this is the site where you feel the pulsation of the radial artery, okay? So this is the superficial palmar arch. This is the deep palmar arch. Now look at this picture. Where whatever I explained in that book, it is there. Okay? So here this is the ulnar artery. Are you following?
Yes.
So ulnar artery runs superficial to the retinaculum, forming superficial palmar arch.
Okay.
So now it is giving one more deep branch. Deep branch which is forming the deep palmar arch. Are you following?
Yes.
So now this is the radial artery.
Okay.
Which goes actually dorsal, see here, which is going dorsal.
Yes.
Okay. One branch, it is anastomosing with superficial arch.
Yes.
Much of the artery is going behind.
Yes.
Shaded here, okay? So there it is giving one branch to the thumb, arterial princeps pollicis. And one branch to the index, artis radialis index. Is it labeled?
Yes.
No. Yeah, radial artery of index finger. So 1, 2, 3. Deep palm arch, artis radialis indicis and princeps pollicis. Clear? And one branch superficial completing the arch. Superficial arch. So deep arch from radial and deep branch from radial. Ulnar.
So the superficial from the radial, it doesn't count from the three.
I didn't get you.
You said just the three from the radial.
After winding round.
Yes.
Before winding round, it gives one branch which completes superficial. Am I clear?
Yes.
After winding round, it terminates by three.
Three.
One forms the deep arch, one to the thumb, one to the index.
Okay.
Before going to the dorsal side, it gives one branch which completes the superficial arch.
Okay.
Clear?
Yes.
So that is the story about the arteries in the upper limb. Arteries in the upper limb. I repeat, brachial artery, or before that, the axillary artery in the axilla. Three parts by pectoralis minor. Three parts, three branches. One first part, one branch, that is highest thoracic. Second branch, two, thoracoacromial and lateral thoracic. Third branch, three, anterior and posterior circumflex humeral and then subscapular. Okay, then lower part of the teres major. The brachial artery, which is superficial. First runs on the medial side and then comes anterior.
Interior.
Goes deeper and then in front of the elbow where it divides into radial line ulnar artery. That is the terminal branches at the level of neck of the radius.
Yes.
So in the arm, the brachial artery is superficial. That's why it is chosen to measure the blood pressure. It gives a big branch called as the profunda brachii artery, which supplies the posterior compartment of the arm.
Yes.
And even it gives ulnar collateral branches, which help in taking anastomosis around the elbow joint. So other than these collateral branches, it gives muscular branches to the anterior compartment muscles and even nutrient branches to the humerus bone. Clear?
The anastomosis in the elbow, two arteries?
Two from the brachial, two from the profunda brachii, and again from the radial and from the ulnar and even from the interosseous also. So down going branch, collaterals,
okay.
Upcoming branch, recurrent. So radial collateral, ulnar collateral.
Okay.
Radial collateral from profunda brachii artery, ulnar collateral from ulnar artery. Brachial artery. Ulnar recurrent arteries from ulnar artery, radial recurrent arteries from radial artery, and intraosseous recurrent arteries from intraosseous artery. All they mix. Okay, form anastomosis around the
elbow
joint. Clear? The terminal branches are radial and ulnar. Radial runs along the lateral side of the forearm along with the bone. So at the rest, this radial artery lies directly on the bone on the anterior surface of the lower end of the radius where we feel the pulsation. Okay. After that, it winds around the wrist, goes to the dorsal side, pierces the first dorsal metatarsal space. Okay, then it goes deep in the palm and terminates by three, making one deep palm arch, one supplying the thumb as arterial princeps pollicis and one the radialis indicis. Okay, the ulnar artery runs along the medial side of the forearm along with the ulnar nerve, enters the hand superficial to the retinaculum. There, much of the artery forms the superficial palm arch. It gives one deep branch which goes deep, completes the deep palm arch with the radial artery.
No finger branches.
If I want, I am telling no. So from this palmar arches, you have metatarsal arteries.
Yes. Okay.
Yes, yes.
Okay. You already learned them in your first year, musculoskeletal system. Okay. These metatarsal arteries, they go at the space between the fingers and then digital.
Yes. Yes.
Proper digital. There is a lot again. I don't want to go into the details again. Okay. Then these, again they give anastomosing branches from the deep palm arch, superficial palm arch, there is anastomosis, there are different, okay? So this is about the arteries in the upper limb. Now come to the veins. So everywhere in the veins you have superficial veins, deep veins.
Yes.
Superficial veins, deep veins. Superficial veins are named. Name is a different name. Whereas deep veins, you all know, they run along with the arteries as vena cavitans. That's why the name of them will be same as the arteries, like radial artery, radial vein, ulnar artery, ulnar vein, brachial artery, brachial vein, axial artery, axial vein. So they are all deep veins.
Yes.
So named after the artery along which they run.
Yes.
Now we are interested in the superficial veins, which are given different name. So there are many superficial veins. Only the big superficial veins are named.
Okay.
Okay. So there are two important veins or important veins, superficial veins in the upper limb. So all the deep veins in the palm or hand, they make an arch. That is called as dorsal venous arch, both in the lower limb as well as in the upper limb. Okay, they make dorsal venous arch. A arch will have two ends. It's like this arch.
Yes,
one the medial end, one the lateral end. So this venous arch, medial end, begins the basilic vein, and the lateral end begins the cephalic vein. Two big veins, superficial veins. Basilic vein, cephalic vein. They run upwards towards the arm. Okay, and these two veins are communicated. So one big vein which communicates basilic with the cephalic in front of the cuboidal fossa. Okay, that is called as median cuboidal vein. What is that vein?
Median
cuboidal vein. A big vein communicates basilic with the cephalic. Am I clear? So that median cuboidal vein is important clinically because that is the vein we use to take the blood sample for investigations. Am I right?
Yes.
Okay. Why this vein is chosen? Because it is big, superficial, and very importantly, it is fixed. Usually, if you want to prick the superficial veins, they move because they are present below the skin. But this vein is fixed by the bicipital aponeurosis. So the biceps muscle tendon, it makes an aponeurosis. That's why this vein is fixed. So if you want to prick, so it will not move. The vein will not move. That's why this vein is chosen. Otherwise, anywhere we can draw the blood. Why only we choose this vein? Because it is fixed. When you try to prick it, it will not move. Am I clear?
Yes.
That's the important point, clinical point. Okay. This medial cuboidal vein is fixed by bicipital aponeurosis. That's why we choose this vein to draw the blood samples. Am I clear?
Yes.
So, basilic vein runs superficial at the middle of the arm. On the middle of the medial side of the arm, it goes deep. It goes deep. This basilic vein is joined by the deep brachial vein. Are you following?
Yes, yes, yes.
The brachial vein along with the brachial artery. So, that brachial vein, basilic vein, joined to form axillary vein. Which runs along with the axillary artery, the sheath.
Mm-hmm.
Then axillary vein continues as subclavian vein. So the subclavian vein joined by internal jugular forms brachiocephalic vein. So brachiocephalic on the right and left, superior vein. Am I clear? So how the axillary vein is formed? By basilic vein and brachial vein. Or some textbooks that describe basilic vein after becoming deep, it continues as axillary vein. But it is joined by brachial vein, a big vein, that is deep vein, which is formed by radial and ulnar vein joining brachial vein, and then brachial vein joining basilic vein.
Yes.
And then, whereas this cephalic vein runs superficial, and then it goes in the deltopectoral groove, and then joins the axillary vein.
Okay.
Am I clear?
Yes.
So that's all about the superficial veins. So I explain again. The deep veins all here in the hand, they form dorsal venous arch from the medial end, basilic vein, lateral end, cephalic vein. They run upwards superficially. Basilic vein enters deep at the middle of the medial side of the arm and joins with the brachial vein to form the axillary vein. Cephalic vein runs along and along the deltas and then the deltopectoral groove joins the axillary vein. So basilic vein and cephalic vein are joined by one median vein that is called the median cuboidal vein in front of the cuboidal fossa, which is fixed by bicipital aponeurosis. That's why it is chosen to draw the blood samples clinically. Clear?
Yes.
This is about the veins of the upper limbs in very brief. Okay?
Yes. Is like a vein, just join with the deep brachial or it's a branch from?
No branch.
So just join.
They just join.
Okay.
Veins never branch.
Yes.
They are tributary. They are formed. Except. Yeah, one portal vein also. Okay, then. Inferior vena cava will not divide. All the veins in the body, they are formed except one, he said, portal vein. Very good. It also divides. One more vein, I explained in the last lab. Here. Retromandibular vein, man. Okay, this is the story what I explained again, the same. Okay? So axillary vein and then subclavian vein, all that sort. So now coming to the lower limb. So lower limb, one big artery which supplies the lower limb is your femoral artery. Femoral artery. Same as, see there you had subclavian, axillary, then brachial. Here you have common iliac dividing into internal and external iliac. External iliac continues as femoral. So you can compare, you can compare this, what is that? Axillary to the external iliac. So we are not studying external iliac because it is restricted to pelvis. Okay? So then the external iliac artery runs behind the inguinal ligament and continues in the anterior side of the thigh as femoral artery. Okay, so femoral artery, counterpart of brachial.
Brachial, yes.
Okay, and then it becomes popliteal behind the knee, but it's not so in the upper limb. So this brachial artery divides into two terminal. Okay, so here the popliteal divides into anterior and posterior tibia.
Okay,
am I clear?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so come again, we'll study that. So you have mainly the femoral artery supplying the lower limb. Other than the lower limb, we even include the gluteal region also. Gluteal region. So gluteal region is supplied by the gluteal vessels which are from internal iliac artery.
Okay.
Gluteal region is supplied by superior and inferior gluteal arteries and even few branches from the femoral also. Okay. So which are from the internal iliac artery, the gluteal arteries. They will be supplying the gluteal region. Other than that, everywhere it is the femoral and the popliteal branches. Clear?
Yes.
And even some small part on the medial side of the thigh, you have the obturator artery, which is coming again from internal iliac. Obturator artery. Okay? You have three important vessels supplying the gluteal, that means the important vessels other than femoral artery branches, they are from internal iliac. What are they? Superior and inferior gluteal and obturator. These are three vessels which are coming from internal iliac supplying the lower limb area, mainly the gluteal region and medial side of the thigh. Clear?
Yes.
Okay. So you have the veins, again very important clinically, because these are the veins of the lower limb, mainly the superficial veins which go for varicosity. Varicose veins, you know?
Yes.
You might have seen some people having tortuous veins.
Yes.
So that is called as varicose veins. Varicose veins are common in lower limbs, mainly the superficial veins. Okay? But that's why they become important clinically. So as I explained, the gluteal region, you have the superior and inferior gluteal arteries, which are from internal iliac. Okay? And you have one more artery, that is the obturator artery. So these are the three, superior gluteal, inferior gluteal, and where is the obturator? These are the three from internal iliac supplying the gluteal region and medial side of the thigh. Okay? So next, the femoral artery. Okay, so this is the inguinal ligament.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
So external iliac continues as femoral artery behind the, or you can say midpoint of the inguinal ligament. From there down, it continues as
femoral artery.
You can feel the pulsation of the femoral artery just below the inguinal ligament, mid inguinal point. Okay, so that continues as femoral artery. So femoral artery in the thigh, in the anterior side of the thigh, the area between the muscles. It's like a triangle, so that is called as femoral triangle. It is there in the femoral triangle. It gives some branches there in the femoral triangle, and then enters a canal. Enters a canal that is called as Hunter's canal or adductor canal. It's all the gross anatomy which you have learnt in your musculoskeletal block. What is that canal called as? Adductor's canal. Adductor's canal or Hunter's canal. Because that is the where artery, it can be compressed. Especially a surgeon by name called as John Hunter. Especially in the first and second, I think the first world war. The world war, where the soldiers, they used to come with multiple injuries to the lower limbs. So they had gangrene. So then he has to amputate the leg. He has to cut the leg, okay, to prevent his death from septic shock. So what he used to do? So before cutting the limb, he has to arrest the blood vessels, right?
Yes.
Then he used to take a rope or a pipe or something like that, and he used to tie around the thigh, and he used to compress this femoral artery in this area. He was knowing that anatomy, and then he used to put that knot over the femoral artery so that he can arrest the bleeding when he is cutting the limb down. So that as he first identified the femoral artery in that canal where it can be compressed, that canal is named after him. That is the Hunter's canal.
Okay.
As it is in the adductor form, that canal is formed by adductor muscles, so that is called as adductor canal. Am I clear?
Yes.
The other name, Hunter's canal or adductor's canal. It runs in the Hunter's canal. So that is the story about the femoral artery. It gives some branches in the femoral triangle. So what are those branches? So it mainly the femoral artery, like brachial artery, supplies all the muscles in the thigh, similar to brachial artery. So one big branch in the brachial artery is profunda brachii artery. Similarly, you have one artery from the femoral that is called as deep artery of the thigh or profunda femoris artery. Profunda brachii, profunda femoris, which goes to the posterior compartment of the thigh. Okay. Other than that, it is having some superficial branches. So I said superficial circumflex iliac artery, then superficial epigastric artery, which run upwards. Some run upwards supplying the anterior abdominal wall, and some run posterior to supply the gluteal region. Okay, and even supply the genital organs, the pudendal arteries. Okay, and you have the one big branch that I was talking to you about, the deep artery of the thigh, similar to profunda brachii in the arm, profunda femoris or deep artery of the thigh, which is a big artery which runs, we can say, parallel to this femoral artery, but it is deep. Okay, here it gives many multiple perforating branches which all supply the